Hello, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today for Expand Your Practice and Credibility by Publishing. So our speaker today is Joryn Jenkins. Joryn has been practicing law for nearly 40 years. She has a wide variety of experience, including working with one of the 10 largest firms in the country in Washington, D.C. Joryn has worked as a government attorney in a mid-sized and in a small boutique firm. She taught law school at Stetson University, and now in her own firm, Open Palm Law, she herself is a small business owner. Joryn is a published author and has written 9 books on collaborative law, as well as a poetry and a memorabilia cookbook. She's the only practicing lawyer in Florida to have been awarded the prestigious A. Sherman Christensen Award presented in the United States Supreme Court. There's only one person annually who earns this honor. A federal judge once explained that Joryn's most admirable traits are her dedication, innovative spirit, and hard work. I've had the distinct pleasure of working with Joryn for nearly 2 years doing her digital marketing, and I can say that I've observed the same dedication, spirit, and level of work as that judge. So without further ado, I would like to have you learn about publishing from the expert herself, Joryn Jenkins.
Publishing is wonderful because it enables you to say what you're thinking to more than one person at a time. But it gives you that credibility, the ability to write clear and compelling blogs, articles, tweets, books that people will read, they'll relate to, and they'll share with others. I include personal stories in my book. So my first collaborative divorce book was War or Peace, and there are personal stories in there. And I've had people who felt like they already knew me because they knew part of my life. They knew what I had been through. But writing also helps you learn and understand your subject matter better, which again leads to credibility because you'll come across as more knowledgeable. Books especially will make you the expert, but blogging can make you an expert. And I'll have Holly talk about blogging when we get to that point. The way you start is by establishing who your avatar is. So when I say avatar, I mean, in this case, who is your reader? Who is it that you're talking to? Who's the perfect reader for you? If you don't know who that is, then your book doesn't yet have a purpose. It doesn't have a pitch. It doesn't know who it is or who it wants to talk to yet. So maybe the way to figure out who your avatar is, and I was talking to an author last night, in fact, who's got a ton of stuff that he's written, but he can't seem to pull it together to make a book, which is how I ended up. I wrote 2 books in 4 months because I'd had so much stuff written. I pulled it all together and lo and behold, it coalesced and there were little gaps here and there that I wrote stuff to fill in, but they knew, the books themselves knew what I wanted to say and where I was going with it and who the avatars were. So picture your perfect reader or a real person. Like in my case, I wanted to talk to my consultations. I wanted to talk to the people I was consulting with who were coming to see me about getting divorced. What did they want to know? What was their big burning question? What were the questions they needed answered? And this works for blogging as well. I did like 32 blogs in a very short period of time because it suddenly occurred to me, okay, I'm going to blog frequently asked questions. What do people ask me? I'm a divorce lawyer. People ask me, if I move out of the house, am I abandoning my interest in the house? No, you're not. And here's why. What are the chances that I'll get 50-50 time sharing with my kids? Talk about that. So think about, are you writing a book for your professional practice? Most of the people that I talk to, that's what they're writing about. That's what they know. That's where their passion is. And so you're talking to your clients, you're talking to your consultations, you're talking to those people. Actually, I wrote a cookbook. I think Holly mentioned it. I wrote a cookbook. My reader was my daughter. The entire book was directed to 18-year-old, 19-year-old women who were leaving home for the first time. That was my perfect reader. That was my avatar. So think about who your avatar is, figure that out pretty quick, and you're well on your way. I will tell you that my books have traveled to Australia without me. They convinced a client's spouse to choose the collaborative process over the courtroom process because the spouse bought one of my books and gave it to her. And I've apparently created a mentoring relationship with someone where I walked into a bar one day with my husband on a Friday night and walked past his table, and a woman jumped up from the table and threw her arms around me. I knew who she was. We had met. We had met tangentially. And she turned to the rest of the people at her table and said, I want you to meet my mentor. This woman is amazing. And she proceeded to say why. She'd read my book. So books can accomplish wonderful things. Blogging in a smaller way can do the same things. So think about, where do you want to publish? Now you've got an avatar. How much do you want to write? Are you going to be writing big pieces, little pieces? You know, someone asked me yesterday, how long does a blog have to be? And the answer is, it's amazing. It morphs over time. Originally, we used to say 300 to 500 words. Don't write more. That's too much. And then Google decided that it was going to look for 2,000 word blogs because they were more important. They were more credible, whatever. So now I tell people anywhere from 3 to 2,000 words, 300 to 2,000 words. Depends on what you're looking for. I'm not going to write 2,000 words once a week. I probably produce 3 blogs a week because I have things to say. This morning I decided, I was doing a conference with somebody and she made a comment about the dog in the room and the fact that at 2 o'clock she had to walk the dog. And I said, I think I'm going to write a blog about overwalking your dog in today's world, because I'm thinking that there's some dogs out there who are definitely getting more exercise than they ever thought they would get, because it's the only way that their parents can get out of the house is by taking the dog for a walk. There's a blog. If you're looking for something to blog about, there's something to blog about every hour of your day. So you write articles, you blog, you tweet about it. Look at your local association. What associations do you belong to? Do they have a publication? Do they have a newsletter? Do they have a website? You can blog for them. You can write little article type of things for them. Those types of things will work for you and work for the rest of us as well who want to read you. You might have your own website and you should certainly get one. You can write for your LinkedIn page. You can write for your Facebook page. You might be writing smaller pieces, shorter pieces, so tweeting. You might have e-zines. In my case, the world of collaborative practice is an e-zine. I had something published this morning. It actually was not a piece that I wrote. It was written about me in Money. So there, look around you. There are what's pertinent to what you want to talk about. Those places will give you credibility in your profession or where you want to be speaking. And then there's also write your very own book. And we will have a portion here on your book. So spread the word about what you're passionate about and establish your own authority. And then the question becomes, how often do you publish? Depends on what you're publishing. So think about that.
That's right. Well, I'd be very happy to talk about that, Joryn. So the wonderful thing about blogging, if you're looking at writing a book, is that it's a way to approach writing in a small, approachable, easy manner, because it's a lot to write a book. I actually just got done helping my mother write a book, and we've been working on it for 10 years. So it's about to be published, but definitely the first book is a little bit like having a baby. So that is the nice thing about blogging, is you can just start the process of writing and you can make your article as short or as long as you want. You can have a 300 word article or you can have a 5,000 word article. What Joryn mentioned earlier about Google is absolutely true. Google has changed their parameters so that they do give preference to articles that are 2,000 words or above. So if you're really trying to leverage your content to help drive traffic to your website, you will make your articles 2,000 words or above. But what I would caution people, because I have seen this, where people don't want to even start the process at all because they're just not up to sitting down and writing a 2,000 word piece. It's absolutely not necessary. Just start with 300 words, 500 words, whatever you can do. Now, if you do a 2,000 word piece, one of the things that you're going to want to do is break it up. Have you ever gone on a website and looked at a very long article and just kind of blown out of it because it's just too much information? And people don't read information that way. In fact, the way people read information is they'll just skim through and they'll look at, obviously, the headline first, but then they look at the secondary, which is called a H2 headline, and the next level of headlines, which is the H3 headlines. In fact, there's just different levels of headlines. And that is actually the way most people peruse the internet these days, is they go to an article and they peruse the headlines and they'll maybe go back and read the entire article, or they just may read one section. So it's very important, if you want people to read your material at all, to break it up into sections that are no longer than 300 words. In fact, a lot of times I say between 200 and 300, and you'll gauge it as you're looking at it in terms of what makes it more readable. The other thing you'll want to do to leverage that content when you're in the process of writing your article is you're going to want to use words that are relevant to what people might be searching for. So if you're writing about, for example, what Joryn writes about, she's writing about family law, she's writing about custody, so she's going to want to use those words, and she does. She's an expert, so she does use those words in her writing. She's using the words family law, she's using the words divorce, she's using the word child custody, if that's what it happens to be about. And those words are often used and need to be used in the headlines as well. So in the H2 headlines and in the H3 headlines, you use those key words because that will help Google find that content that you've written on the internet. The other thing that you want to do, and this feeds right into what Joryn's talking about in terms of putting together a book, because you can take these blogs and you can leverage the content and you can create a book. The way that you do it to help it also leverage it for SEO is you'll create what's called content clusters. So if, for example, in Joryn's industry, family law, she'll have a number of articles, and she has hundreds and hundreds of articles. She has so much content, it's amazing. And it's terrific for SEO, for search engine optimization, because you can link back and forth between articles that are on the same topic. So an article that's on child custody, we're able to link one article of hers that's like a pillar article to other cluster content, key cluster content on her website. So that's also very important. And the thing is that for anybody who has a business, you want people to come to your website. So you want to be creating content because that does make it something that Google likes. They see that you're active on your website. They see that you're updating the content. And so they will rank it higher.
They also see people are visiting with you. They see that people like that content. So I did 6 blogs this past week on the safer at home protocol, the quarantine, and how it impacts on family law. So people are looking at that. That's going to also that fact. So the clustering coupled with newsworthy topics, right?
That's right. That's exactly right. And one of the things that Joryn does so well is she leverages all of her content, and we do this with all of our clients. We leverage it with social media. So you can publish the fact that you've done an article in social media on LinkedIn, Twitter, Facebook, and you can also use it for emails that you send out to your list. So the thing is that it is work to put together content, but it's not just a one-time thing. The other thing that can also be done that a lot of people don't know is that you can syndicate your content. So we just actually, one of our clients just wrote up a 2,000 word blog, and it's getting syndicated over the next 4 weeks by 100 different news sources. And so that creates backlinks back to her site. Content is king, and a lot of sites and a lot of news sites are out there and they want that content. And so they are very grateful and they will use that, and then they'll put backlinks to your site. So I think that's pretty much everything that I wanted to cover relative to blogging.
One of the big questions that I got yesterday, even though I wasn't specifically talking about publishing, I was talking about mostly the big picture of marketing, but publishing is a critical element of that. And so I got this email afterwards, you know, I'm so concerned that the book that I want to write has already been written. And I laughed out loud. It's a terrible thing because one of the things that I always tell people is you're going to offer a unique perspective simply by virtue of the fact that you're who you are and there's nobody like you. There's only one you. So your perspective is going to be unique. Write about something in your profession that bothers you. Take a stand and become known for taking that stand. That will be part of your brand. It'll become part of who you are and you'll be known for that. That's part of your credibility. So other tips, I suppose, always include the specific next step that you want your reader to take right after they finish reading. Is that always going to be a sales job? No, I wrote a blog about being at home with the kids and how everyone thinks that we have so much more time because we're stuck at home. But you know what? She's got an infant. She's got a small child. I wrote it from that perspective. She's become chief cook and bottle washer where she was working from home before, but the kids were in daycare and they were, you know, and she had a housekeeper and whatever. Now she's the cook. She's the full-time maid. She's the full-time caregiver. She's partially her husband's secretary. She has no time at all. And so my call to action in that blog was take a few minutes for yourself every day. If you're one of those people who are stay at home, then make sure that you include 10 minutes, 20 minutes, 30 minutes, and you protect it. And your family knows that that's your time for you. So always include a call to action because that's part of publishing. Publish in the appropriate journals. Research the journals that you want to get published in and then find out what their rules and procedures are because every journal is different. Get featured as a contributor in a relevant magazine. I had a phone call from Laura Wasser, who is known as the divorce lawyer for the stars. If you know anything about celebrity divorces, she's the lawyer. Her initials are Laura, L-A-W, Laura A. Wasser. Her father's a lawyer. She's in practice with her father. She got in touch with me because she has a blog called It's Over Easy, the divorce. It's over easy for some people. And she wanted some of my content. So I post for her every once in a while. Post regularly. Holly, this is something that you always talk about. Post regularly. If you're going to be a regular writer, if you find out that it really is not that hard for you, then maybe come up with a schedule where you post tips on one day of the week, you post frequently asked questions on another day of the week, you post stories or maybe personal stories another day of the week. So come up with some kind of schedule. Maybe you post every Monday. Maybe you post once a month on the first. But Holly and I have a blogger that we like to look at who posts regularly, but it's like once every 2 weeks. And she's hilarious. She's just
hilarious. I'm so glad you brought that up, Joryn, because that was one of the things I meant to say. If you have a regular schedule like that, it does help Google, and they do prefer that. So it will also help with your SEO.
A regular schedule. You don't have to write on a regular schedule, although that may work for you. My regular writing schedule was get in the car, drive to the office, write while I talk. I talk to Siri on my way to the office, and I can dictate a 500-word blog in the 12-minute drive on my way to the office. When you're blogging, make sure, like Holly said, use keywords. That's critical. And by the way, always try and use good grammar, syntax, and spelling. People should write better than they speak. Readers will read better than we write, and certainly better than they speak. So I know that sounds weird, but it's a rule. It's a truism. Be choosy when you're submitting articles to journals for publication. Don't submit an article to 5 different journals at the same time. That's not fair to them, but also be realistic. Don't submit to journals that are going to turn you down. And be sure to take positive criticism and apply it. It's meant well, so take it well. It may be that they're telling you how to get this piece published if you do this and this, so try to help them get you published. I like to keep records of my cases. That's, again, how I got so much material. I was already blogging, so I had all the blogs, but I also had my cases. I had letters written in them. I had memos of law that I had written, and, you know, not a lot of that got into the books, but some of it did. Some of the details about the stories that I might have forgotten over time, you know, 10-year-old cases, they go away. Memories fade, we like to say in the law, and they do. So take notes, keep a journal. Why not? If you're not going to write today, but you might write in 10 years, keep a journal. I want to talk about books. So let me move on to, you've got to map out your book before you do anything else, really. And let me take that back. If you're blogging, you're already writing your book. If you're blogging, that's going to be your book. Some of it may not get into your book, because when you throw it all in a pile, like I did, not a literal pile, but a mental pile, there was stuff that didn't belong in my book, and it went out. And you may find that you have gaps that you have to fill. I mean, it may be that you only use half of your blogs and you still have to write half of your book. But for now, let's lay bare some of the mysterious secrets of manuscript writing. Holly took 10 years. That's because that's who Holly is in writing a manuscript like that. And she was working with another person, so they had both of their personalities involved. I have an addictive personality. I took up smoking at one point when I was very young, and I smoked heavily for 7 years. Quitting was the hardest thing I ever did, and that includes getting divorced. I have an addictive personality. When I started writing a book, I was on it. I lived it, I breathed it, I ate it. I did some client work on the side. It seemed like that because I was up till 2 every morning writing my book. Everybody's different. And so, you know, you're just going to have to find out what kind of author you are. I want you to think about what your dedication is going to look like. Your book will commence with a dedication. Make it short and concise. Consider why you're writing the book. I mean, we've talked about this already. So who's your avatar? What's your book's pitch? What position are you taking in this book? What's your passion? What are you trying to tell us about the world, about one aspect of the world? So that will help you figure out what your dedication is. Your dedication will help you advance your mission and promulgate your passion. So that's what your dedication. So I'll give you some examples. These are kind of funny for me. I'd like to thank Mr. Trundle, my 8th grade English teacher, for always being there for me when I was first learning to write creatively. It's true. I want to dedicate this book to my husband, Tom, for thanks for being so supportive and for standing by me all these years. I dedicate this book to the innumerable couples who are changing the way the world gets divorced by discovering the advantages of being divorced collaboratively, both for themselves and for their children. Now, those are all true for me. I never actually used those dedications, strangely, because I had even better ones for each book. But as it is, that's it. So now, forward. First of all, learn to spell the word forward. It is not F-O-R-W-A-R-D, as my graphic artist put it in a full-size poster for me, and I did not catch it until I saw the poster already produced at $400. So I have a typo on a huge poster that I subsequently replaced, but it was a $400 error. Forward means before the word, before the body of your book. And so it's spelled F-O-R-E-W-O-R-D. As an author, you should consider who would be the right person to write your forward for your manuscript. And again, you want to consider your mission. The secret here is to find the most famous or well-respected person, maybe in your industry, who can support the vision of your book. If it's a business book, then the top person in your industry. You may want to consider asking an appropriate celebrity. I've done both. So my first book, War or Peace, the guy who invented the collaborative divorce process, Stu Webb, I reached out to him and he said yes. And to me, that was shocking. He said yes. Now, there's a secret to asking someone to write a foreword for you. You actually write the foreword yourself, but we'll get to that. The second person that I asked to write the second foreword for me, I decided to ask, first I was going to ask Judge Judy, and I couldn't figure out how to get past her, whoever it is who's in front of her. So I ended up asking Judge Alex, who, as it turned out, I thought he was practicing law in Miami because that's where he was from, but he actually was practicing law here where I am in Tampa. And he was at a firm that I know well. So I reached out to someone else in the firm and I said, can you tell me how to approach Judge Alex about writing my foreword? And so I got an introduction and I asked Judge Alex to write the foreword and he said, absolutely. And I assured him, I'll take care of writing it for you. So I wrote Judge Alex's foreword and I sent it to him. And the trick in writing a foreword is that it's a marketing tool. The person who writes it will inevitably market the book to his contacts, his followers, his connections, and you will use his name to market the book to your perfect readers. So you have to make sure that you give him a copy of the book, probably before it's published, so that he can say that he read it. He probably won't read the entire book. He may read parts of it. You hope he reads parts of it. And then once you've written the book and published it, please don't forget to give him at least one copy, which he'll put proudly up on his own bookshelf. But in the meantime, when you write the foreword, because it's a marketing piece, you're going to tell people how wonderful Judge Alex is. For example, so I started his foreword by explaining his own background, how many years in practice, how many years as the top TV show, I forget what you call those TV shows, I don't watch much TV, but courtroom drama, maybe courtroom real life. So I wrote this foreword. And then I went into what a wonderful book I had written and why you should read it from his perspective. So these are his words on the paper. I sent the foreword to him to read. And he looked at it and he edited it, which I had told him to do. And he took out all the bragging. Big mistake. You, the author, want the foreword to brag about the author of the foreword. Because there may be people who pick the book up who don't know who Judge Alex is. They sort of recognize his name, and you're going to put on the cover that the foreword is by Judge Alex. So you really have to have the bragging in there. And so I wrote back to him and I said, Alex, I so appreciate that it makes you uncomfortable to have this stuff here, but this is why it's written that way. Go look at any foreword, any book in your library, look at the foreword. That's what it's supposed to do. So he agreed to, it didn't take much arguing. He put it all back in, and that's what that foreword looks like. So the question is, how do you ask for a foreword? There's some advisors who recommend against sending an email. They may say that you ought to send a short video or send it in a direct tweet to the people you're targeting it. You should definitely tell them who you are, what you do, why you've written the book, what the purpose of the book is. Be complimentary of the person that you're asking. I suggest that if it's possible, you say that that person has made you better at whatever it is that you do, because that's why you're asking him. So you thank him for that. And then you respectfully request that he do you the honor of writing the foreword to your book, a book that maybe without his influence, you would never have written. So that'll help get him to consider your request. I've always done it by email and I've been very successful in that. I'm not precisely sure, I still am not exactly sure why. Now with Alex, I requested an introduction. Stu Webb may have heard of me already, but I kind of doubt it. I don't think that I had the credibility before I wrote War Peace that I do now. I have a lot more credibility behind me than I ever had before. Consider all that. Now, what about testimonials? Most of the books that you pick up still have a section in them, or do have a section in them, what people are saying about this book. And those are what we call testimonials. You may call them testimonials, you may call them book reviews. Often on the back of a book, you'll see the top three reviews there, or the most important three reviews written by the most important three people. So who are you going to ask for testimonials? Well, it depends on your profession. It depends on what the purpose of your book is. But most of the time, You're going to ask clients. You're going to ask other professionals who do what you do. And you're going to ask celebrities. You might want to send out as many as 30 requests to celebrities on your list. So that's how Laura Wasser, I think, knew who I was, because I had actually approached her about a book review and she gave me one, which was very nice of her. She may actually have ended up on the back of that book, because getting a review from someone like Laura Wasser in my profession is pretty big. I'm not sure if she ended up on the back of my book or not, because I have been able to get some really fine reviews. I really wanted to get Robin Williams's review. He had a collaborative divorce and he died a couple of months before I published my book. I wasn't able to do that, which was very sad. Clients and professionals will be flattered that you ask. I've had a 90% success rate with those requests. Celebrities, of course, are much more difficult to get them from. Unless they're, maybe you might already share a connection. So my sister is a celebrity, so I got her review. And if they're actively promoting their profiles online, it's likely to be easier. So send your requests with sample testimonials. Again, you're not exactly writing the testimonial for them, but you're making it far easier for them to say yes. You want to make it easy to say yes. So a testimonial for the book should not be about how great you are. It should be about how great the book is. So you've got to send a PDF of your book. You need to create a PDF that can't be edited. I think you can still do that. And the testimonial should be about the book. Something like, this book contains the most revolutionary and innovative thinking I've heard in 10 years. If you're considering divorce, you must read this book to understand the enormity of the choice of process you have to make. That was one of my sample testimonials. Did someone give me a testimonial that actually read like that? That read like that, yes, but not that. I made that up. Consumer testimonials should be from people who are in your target audience, your clients, whether they were direct clients or not, you can go to them. Expert testimonials, maybe, should be from people who are at the top of your field or in related fields. So like, I do divorce work, I'm a lawyer, but there are CPAs who do divorce work, and so I could get CPA testimonials. And obviously that testimonial will be tailored accordingly. Which celebrities you ask will depend on who you know and who your contacts know. So I reached out to someone at the law firm where Judge Alex was working because I knew that person, and that worked out very well for me. Once you request a testimonial, make sure you pin the guy or gal down to a date. They need a deadline. You need to give them a deadline, and then you need to follow up on the deadline to make sure that you get it. Otherwise, some of those testimonials will drop off the edge of the ocean and you'll never get them. Now you've got an introduction. Your introduction in the book. That's your opportunity to introduce your reader to your passion. Communicate why you've dedicated time and energy to writing this book. It's all about the emotion behind the book and the heart that you put into it, the heart that you put into what you do. It's a marketing piece about you as a person, but it's also about your vision, your passion, your mission. Your introduction should encourage your reader to feel that you are credible and influential, honest and trustworthy, and that your mission is worthwhile. So you're going to have to talk about where you're coming from. To some degree, it may feel make you feel uncomfortable because you're going to do a little bragging. You need to talk about what makes you credible. And if, like me, you got an award in the United States Supreme Court that's only given out once a year to one person, and the Supreme Court doesn't give out awards very often, then you need to tell the reader that. They don't know that. You know that. Your friends know that. Some of your friends know that. You'd be surprised how many of your friends don't know that. There are details about your life that you think are well known, and they're just not. So share what makes you credible and influential. Explain why you love doing what you do. Where's your drive coming from? You need to enlighten the reader as to that. And if you don't love what you do, then it's going to look like you're doing this strictly for the money. And by the way, you're really not going to make money publishing a book. You might make some money, but chances are, I'd say 9 out of 10 authors don't make money. And we're not in it for the money making. We're in it for the credibility, for the influence. I usually give my books away, to be honest with you. I give them to people that I want to learn about collaborative divorce. I give them to potential clients. I talked to a woman this morning down in Boca who is trying to start a pro bono collaborative divorce project. And I told her I'd send her 10 of my books to use to get legal services to send her cases. So your book is going to be a marketing tool more than anything else. And you don't want to come across like all you're doing is trying to make money. So let's talk about the content. Most authors of business books start by developing a chapter map. They map out the entire book before they even start the writing process. So where are you going to start and where do you want to end up? And then what are the steps along the way? Now, having said that, it was fairly easy for me because the collaborative process, we have a roadmap. And so I looked at the roadmap and I did a chapter on each step of the roadmap. So I started here and I ended up, started at the beginning of a divorce and ended up at the end of a divorce. And then in between, I also talked about the different professionals who can get involved in the divorce. So the lawyers, the facilitators, the financial neutrals. So I wrote a chapter for each of those. And also I wrote a story about a case that I had, a client that I had, who used that lawyer or that neutral in a certain way, or at some stage of the process that I'd just done a chapter on, had a problem that we solved. So the book basically mapped a divorce. And that's going to be true of 9 out of 10 of your business books. You're going to be able to, if you know what your book is trying to tell the world, then you're going to know where to start and you're going to know where to finish. And then you just have to figure out how to get there and what the steps are. There are shortcuts to content creation. Holly and I talked about that earlier. If you've blogged at all, throw all those in a pile. If you write as part of your profession, throw that stuff in the pile. If you're a contractor and you're writing a book about building downtown office buildings, then there are letters that you've written, there are designs that you've created, there are problems that you've had that you've had to do emails about. All that stuff is potential content for your book, depending on what your book is trying to say. If you're interested in what I do as a book coach and what I do as a publisher or a publishing coach, you can find that stuff. I think you can find it on openpalmpress.com. Get in touch. I'm happy to help. I am all about helping other people do what I've done because I love what I've done. I love what I do. And other people love what they do and they want to repeat. You know, and why should they have to do all the reading that I did if I can help them do that? And someone sent me an email last night and I responded because I was interested. And he goes, oh my God, you really, you know, I would never have written to you, but you said, go ahead. And I did. And I didn't expect to get an answer right away. This is amazing. So I've got a new friend, which is so lovely. So back to content. We talked about shortcuts to content creation. I would say, in all fairness, if you've been doing what you've been doing for 20 years, go back as far as you can and collect all that information. You just don't know what of that is going to be useful to you. Letters to clients, blogs, articles, summaries of interviews, emails, forms, anything that you've created, graphs, maps, building designs. I don't know, because I don't know, you know, what you do. I actually, one of my books, half of it really was forms that I'd created. So I started a pro bono project. And in the project, we wrote letters, we created forms for legal documents, all kinds of forms. And half the book was forms because people who buy a how-to handbook, and this basically was that, it's called a free divorce project. How to create a free divorce project. I think the book is A Free Divorce. And then the subtitle is How to Organize a Collaborative Divorce Project. they want the forms. So I gave them the forms, and it's a big fat book, but I really only had to write half of it because I'd already written the other half. So there's all kinds of shortcuts. For those of you who present well, especially if you're not as comfortable with writing, record your presentations. Record the Q&A after the presentation, because now if you've recorded the presentation, like, take a look at this presentation. I have taken presentations just like this. I've sent them to fiverr.com. So the word five with two R's at the end, fiverr.com, meaning $5. And I've hired people on Fiverr to transcribe this presentation. That could be a chapter in a book about publishing. Obviously, it needs to be cleaned up, but you've created a whole bunch of words that go in order. And now you don't have to do the rough draft. You've got a rough draft. Presentations are great for that. And Q&As are fabulous because now you know the big burning questions that your authors want to know about, because those are the questions that people asked in the room. Interestingly, something that I discovered along the way, how many of you have gotten on Google and said, asked a question like that? And you watch what Google fills in as your choices. If you can ask a question like that about your profession, you're going to see what people want to know about. And that's fascinating, because that will give you a little bit of insight into where you might want to go with your book. All right, let's talk about the length of your book. A good business book can be between 35,000 words and 70,000 words. 35,000 words is going to be a pretty short book. However, keep in mind that that's the content. Then you've got what readers are saying about this book. You've got your introduction. You've got your foreword. You've got your testimonials. You've got a dedication page. You've got your copyright page. And then you may have at the end about the author page. We didn't talk about that. You might have an about the author page. So when you add all of that, you might have another 5,000 to 15,000 words on top of your 35,000 words. The first book I wrote, my first book was 54,330 words, War or Peace. So again, if you want a sample, you can get that on my website, Open Palm Press, and you'll see what a book like that is going to look like. It was 168 pages long in a 6x9 format, which is a standard layout for a business book. My second book was 63,219 words long, and it was 220 pages, also 6x9 format. So let's think about that for a second. Typical chapter can be 2,000 words. Really short chapter, 1,000 words. Fairly long chapter, 5,000 words. 35,000 words. If you're writing really long chapters, that's only 7 chapters. If you're writing medium-sized chapters, 14 chapters, 15 chapters. Let's say that you take your blogs and you put your blogs together and you go, oh, I don't have to write anything more. That's my book. I have a book. Oh, but it's too short because I need 35,000 words. Each blog is 500 words. Take each blog and expand on what you said in the blog. You were pretty pithy in the blog. You expand that blog. You tell a longer story. If you're telling the story of something about what happened, then you start adding in your adjectives and your adverbs, and you describe the room that the event happened in, and you describe what people were wearing. And now your chapter is 2,500 words. So in some respects, it's not hard to create a book. It's just that people look at a book and go, I can't do that. That's, oh my gosh, me write a book? Are you kidding me? I don't have a book in me. But you do, and you know it. There are many aspects to writing your book that are intangible. You need to evince emotion and evoke that emotion in your readers. The words you choose can help you do that. There are plenty of books on writing that are wonderful to read. Again, I have a recommended reading list. I can send you that. All you have to do is email me. I'm happy to share that. It's about 18 months old now. I haven't updated it, but it's got the good, good writing books on it, the good storytelling books on it, and that will help you. with all of this. Let me just make sure that I've covered everything because we're in the last 3 minutes and I could spend more time talking about the, you know, a motivational book. If you're writing motivational book, you're going to pepper your manuscript with words and phrases like motivation, exhilarating, gets my heart pumping, life-changing, dare, inspiration, drive. There's certain words, enthusiasm, spur, stimulate. There are certain words that evoke certain emotions. You just need to decide ahead of time, what kind of book are you writing? You want to make sure that you're writing a book that readers want to keep reading. So in chapter 2, say, but I'll get into detail about this in chapter 6. So you don't ever have to make that kind of mistake. And that will make them want to read chapter 6. So there are little hooks that you can put in your book as you, and you can go back after you've written the content and do that. You can build those hooks in after the fact. You don't have to do it while you're writing it. In fact, that doesn't make sense because you may juggle the way it lays out. You may decide, oh no, chapter 2 really belongs at chapter 7. And then all of a sudden you've got chapter 2, not in front of chapter 6, but behind it. So just be aware of that. You don't have to write the entire book in one piece. You can go back and figure it out. I don't think you need an epilogue. You do need a call to action. And that's same idea, critical. Call to action. Always include a call to action. What do you want the reader to do when he's done with your book? You might want an acknowledgement setting. I have them in my books. I think it's important. And then there's the about the author. You might also want to include a source list. If you quoted statistics, quotes, or other authors to lend credibility to what you've said, include that information here after the substance. After all, why not? It's an extra page or two, right? But good luck with your book, and I'll be happy to hear more about your personal book if you choose to reach out to me, joryn@openpalmlaw.com. I'm here for you. I want you to help me help you create your 2020 marketing plan. I want to know the questions that you still have. I want to know what tips you think that I can help you cover. You can reach me at joryn@joryn.jenkins.com. You can visit my website, www.joryn.jenkins.com. I also offer collaborative coaching. I offer weekly masterminds. I offer webinars. I offer toolkits. I also have a week-by-week, year-long marketing plan that will help you personalize your own marketing program for the year 2020. It will help you change the way the world gets divorced in your venue, wherever that is. Or you can buy my book, Changing the Way the World Gets Divorced. The subtitle is Marketing Your Collaborative Practice at joryn.jenkins.com. Thank you so much.